Good morning, Timberland family. Will you guys take a second to greet one another as we take a commercial break? Okay, a couple announcements this morning. The Men's Fellowship Bible Study will be Thursday, November 9th. That's this Thursday, right? Yeah, wow. Okay, and that's at Pastor David's house at 7 p.m. The second is volunteers to help the church, the same kind of thing, refreshments, greeting tables, AV setup. That's the tech team. If there's anything that, God has been putting on your hearts, to come forward, talk to Pastor Dave. If anyone wants to help with treats for after service, there's a sign-up sheet on the greeting table. And the last one is the shoe boxes are due next Sunday as we greet. And if you'd all join me in standing as we read scripture, we're going to be in Psalm 122, verses 1 through 9. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." Our feet have been standing within your gates, O Jerusalem. Jerusalem, built as a city that is bound firmly together, to which the tribes go up. The tribes of the Lord, as we decreed for Israel, to give thanks to the name of the Lord. Their thrones for judgment were set, the thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they be secure who love you. Peace be within your walls and security within your towers. For my brothers and companions' sake, I will say, peace be within you. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your good.
To the cross I look, to the cross I cling, of its suffering I do drink, of its work I do sing, for on in my Savior, both bruised
Thank you. deep the Father's love for us. How vast beyond all measure that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns His face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. On His shoulders, ashamed to hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held Him there until
Father, we just praise You. We thank You for King Jesus, Lord. We thank You, God, for Him being the propitiation for our sins, God. We thank You, that God, that through Him we can come and approach the throne of grace with all confidence, God. We love You and we praise You, God. Just continue to let Your Spirit reign here as we continue this service for Your glory. In Jesus' name.
Okay, so looks like today we're going to be praying for Sherry, Kim, and Susie Whitsett. They have COVID. The upcoming Men's Fellowship Bible. That was pretty cool because just as we've grown and as more people have come, there's actually been a desire for men to press in, and there's just something of such an importance to that as you know we fellowship with Christ that we dive into the Word and allow it to change us from the heart. Prayer for more people to come and join our fellowship to know Jesus for Heath, Kenny Knight, Ricky Lawrence, JT, Alora's coworker, and the Aguilar family. Unspoken prayer. Is there anyone else that has prayer and a need for prayer at this time or praise reports? Okay, well, Father, we just pray right now over this time. I pray over Pastor Dave, over his words, that they would be yours spoken to our hearts. God, I just ask that your Spirit fill this place, that we welcome you here. We know that without you, all this is meaningless. And so as we allow your words to change our hearts, would it bleed out into our actions and affect this community? That, the relationships that we have with people, the loving relationships that we have with each other would just be so attractive to this broken world that they would know a love that they have not seen before and come to a saving faith in you. We love you, Lord. I ask that you bless this time. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Good morning again, everybody. Thank you guys for joining. I'm going to turn this way so I'm not looking over there at the doors. Let's see here. All right. So glad you guys can join us today. It's a funny morning. It's been a funny week, actually. Like, we have all this rain, and it's all wet and everything, but it's been warmer, so I don't know what I like better. I don't know if I like cold and dry or wet and warm, right? I mean, it's, you know, pick your poison, right? But it's been a blessing. It's been a good week, and I'm just so happy to be here worshiping the Lord with all of you today. And my hope always, you know, as Brother Dakota was alluding to, with us going out into the community and allowing, you know, what we receive from God through His Word, through His truth, you know, to kind of show itself outwardly to our community. Our hope is that, you know, we could minister to this community with the hands and feet of Christ, you know, just loving on them, showing them, you know, how much God loves them, and all for the sake of God's glory, but also for the sake that some might be saved, you know. I don't necessarily like, although I am long-winded at times, I don't like to stand up here and just talk or teach. I mean, that's not my goal. If that was the goal, I'd just be home. You know what I mean? I would just be home teaching my children and stuff. But my hope is that, as the Word teaches in the book of Ephesians, that something that God imparts through me to you might equate to you being a brighter light where God has you in your jobs, in your homes, in your families, as parents, as spouses, as, you know, whatever you are to the people around you, so that some of those people might be able to experience, you know, redemption in Christ. And just like God, you know, my hope is that all would be saved. I know that's not going to happen, but I let God worry about those details, and I do what I'm called to do. So I pray that this message will bless you today, that it will definitely brighten your light as a lamp unto Christ for His glory. And I do want to remind you that, you know, last week we thought we were going to get through the book of, or actually chapter 2 of Colossians, but that did not happen. You know, we had 8 verses to go through. We got through 2, you know. So I think I said this last week, and I'm going to be cautious here, Lord. I think we could get through today. But I wanted to remind you that, you know, what we really talked about is that we have freedom in Jesus Christ. You know, we're free. I mean, do you guys know that? Like, raise your hand if you know that you are free in Christ, and there's nothing you need to do to be saved. Nothing. Christ has done it all. He's paid it all. It's in Christ that God is pleased. And when you put your faith in him, everything that Christ accomplished, everything, his holy life, his righteousness, you know, all of the fulfillment of the feasts and the moons and the offerings and the sacrifices, all of the fulfillment of all the covenants that God expects of his people are fulfilled for you. His righteousness imputed to you because you've placed your faith in him. And some people might say, well, that sounds pretty far-fetched, Dave. Well, I didn't say it. God said it. And, you know, God is the sovereign king of all things. And if he decreed it, it's a done deal. You know, I don't know if you've ever had anybody in your life who's been, like, faithful all of the time. I don't know that I've ever met anybody like that. I think even at times, you know, because we are broken people and we make mistakes, we're not always able to be completely faithful to each other. But I'll tell you right here and now, God is faithful. God is faithful. He's a faithful God. So you can rest in the freedom that you have in Christ. And so last week we talked about the freedom specifically regarding legalism, right? And, you know, trying to do additional things, recognize things, don't do this, do this, don't do that, in order to be saved along with faith in Christ. And Paul, writing this letter to the Colossians, is like saying, guys, don't do that. You know, if you start trying to think that there's something that you can do in addition to believing in Jesus Christ to be saved, you're forfeiting your gift, the gift of salvation. Just rest in your faith. Just rest in your faith. Continue in the faith, you know. So it's really important that you guys understand that regarding legalism, and there's going to be people that try to put things on you. They're going to try to say, well, you know, you better be doing this, and, you know, you should be doing that, you know. And please, don't fall into that trap. Because, again, then it comes back to you and what you can do, not in what Christ has already done for you. The other thing I want to say, too, regarding that from last week, regarding legalism, is don't judge people, you know. Like, you're going to look at people sometimes, and it's really, really hard not to look and judge when someone's doing something that you don't think is quite kosher. And you know they're a Christian, and you know they're running around telling everybody that they're Christian. It's kind of hard not to want to judge them, you know. It's kind of hard, like, you're tempted to do that, you know. But the truth is that, and this is another one of those participation things. Raise your hand if you believe that God can finish the work in you that he wants to do regarding sanctification. I believe that. I can't do it. I know he can do it. So here's the question. If he can do that for you, can he do that for the person that you look at and say, why are they acting like this, Lord? You know, it's not the same thing as them practicing a sin as much as, it, you know, maybe they're just, you know, not there yet. Maybe they're not in that area as mature as you, you know. What you need to do is maybe talk to them about it with love and then pray for them, but never judge them and never try to put this weight on them. And so, you know, judgment, just a crazy thing. The bottom line is that we are absolutely alive in Christ by faith. We're under grace, not law, apart from legalism. And Paul addressed this with our verses we read last week. So let me just read those two verses to you really quickly, and then I'll pray, and we will go into to our text today. Verse 16 and 17 from Colossians chapter 2. And Paul writes this regarding legalism. He says, therefore, let no one pass judgment on you. Some of your translations will say, let no one condemn you in questions of food and drink, or with regard to a festival, or a new moon, or a Sabbath. These are a shadow of the things to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. Paul is saying, legalism does not save. Christ saves. Today, regarding us being alive in Christ, we're going to go on the other side of this, right? Because we got legalism that Paul spoke against, and now he's going to speak about spiritualism. And whoa, howdy. We know there's a lot of spiritual people in the world, huh? And there's a lot of different ways that you can be spiritual. And everybody's got 8 books on the topic, and everybody has their opinion on it. And what I call that is a bunch of mumbo-jumbo New Age stuff that really, at the end of the day, has not changed. It just has a different label, a different brand, and a different way to deceive people away from Christ. And so we're going to talk about that because, again, we indeed are free and alive in Christ alone by faith, apart from legalism and apart from spiritualism. Let's say a quick prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word. We thank you, God, for this place that you've provided to us to assemble and to worship you and to be fed by you spiritually. We just pray that your Holy Spirit would speak through me. Lord, quiet me now and speak through me, and let your Spirit give discernment, God, in the hearts and the minds of all who will hear your truth today, Father. We pray that you would be glorified in all that we do, and again, that we'd be drawn closer to you, fallen even more in love with you, God, in relationship, Father, for your praise. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. So Paul continues there in verse 18, and he just finished up with legalism. Again, we had a big old deal last week. We talked about it, so I'm not going to go back into that. And he says this after legalism, verse 18. He says, let no one disqualify you, insisting on asceticism and worship of angels, going on in detail about visions, puffed up without reason by his sensuous mind, and not holding fast to the head, from whom the whole body, nourished and knit together through its joints and ligaments, grows with a growth that is from God. And so these two verses regarding spiritualism, and keep in mind, guys, Paul has now switched. We're talking about spiritualism now, right? Because we know Christianity really consists of both these things, right? It consists of the outward, what we do, but it also consists of the inward. And so Paul is addressing both these things because, remember, it's the Gnostics at this time that were trying to get the Colossian Christians to participate in legalism and spiritualism and faith in Christ to be saved. And Paul is saying, no, you don't need legalism, you don't need spiritualism, you are saved indeed alone by faith in Jesus Christ. And so he's addressing this problem now, this danger, if you will, of spiritualism, and he's saying, listen, let no one disqualify you. And that's kind of a scary thing, guys, right? And listen, when I say what I say, I'm not trying to jolt you or make you doubt anything. I just want you to know that there is a possibility for disqualification if you decide that there's something you can do physically or spiritually apart from your faith in Christ. Again, Paul is saying that no one disqualify you, insisting on asceticism and worship of angels, okay? Some of your translations where it says disqualify will say beguile. And really what it means, guys, is it means to enchant you in a way to deceive you, to trick you, so that you will lose your prize. You know what I'm saying, guys? And so, again, the Gnostics were trying to make the Colossians believe that somehow, through spiritualism, they could be more spiritual for God and therefore be more acceptable to God. But Christian, I cannot tell you enough. I cannot tell you enough. You are complete in Jesus Christ. Forget about all that stuff, okay? And listen, don't get all concerned here. We're not talking about things that you're doing like, to worship God. Some of you might do things that you believe you should be doing to worship God, and that's okay. Some people won't do those things in their worship of God, and guess what? That's okay. What's important is that you do all, or you don't do all, by faith. Do you guys see what I'm saying? That's what's the most important thing. And so Paul is saying, don't let anybody beguile you. Don't let anybody disqualify you. Don't let anybody make you think you have to be more spiritual. And he says this, insisting on asceticism. Now, that word asceticism is just a 50-cent word, which means false humility, okay? And if you were to look that up in the dictionary, it means severe discipline and avoidance of all forms of indulgence, typically for religious reasons. And you guys know what I'm saying, right? Because people will go to great lengths to try to be more religious in what they do or what they don't do, right? I remember years ago, before I was even a Christian, I was still like an undevout Catholic. In the Philippines, it's a very Catholic, culture. From my culture on Guam, where I'm from, on that island, it's also very Catholic. I think Magellan kind of went to all these places and brought Catholicism, right? But there was a guy who during Easter time, resurrection time, he decided he wanted to climb up on a cross, right? And be like Jesus, you know? And he thought somehow that would put him in greater graces with God through this, taking himself and putting him up there and suffering. I'll tell you what, they put him on the cross, and they didn't even nail his hands. They tied his hands and his feet to this cross. Brother lasted 5 minutes. It was too much. You know what I'm saying? I mean, it was really sad. But the point is that these are the types of things that people will do, and then they'll try to put them on other people. And they try to make you, they say, well, you know, you really got to make yourself suffer. You really got to push yourself through suffering. You really got to, you know, hurt your flesh, maim your flesh. Your flesh is wicked. Maim it, man. And the truth is that our flesh is wicked. But I'll tell you something, Christian. If you are walking in this world in a way that you're trying to glorify God through Jesus Christ, proclaiming the truth of God, proclaiming the gospel of Christ, you don't have to try to suffer. You will suffer. That's just the truth. Because this world, although a lot of times they'll say, you know, we really love Jesus, we just hate Christians. We hate the way Christians are so judgmental and they do this and they don't do that. And they, you know, I'll tell you right here now, Christians that are walking with the Lord, they're only doing what Jesus did. And the very people that say that they love Jesus but they hate Christians, really, they're coming from that same spirit as the Pharisees back in the day when Jesus was walking on the earth, guys. Okay? So this idea of, you know, making yourself suffer, depriving yourself of something, you know, this type of a thing, because it's going to make you more spiritual before the Lord, wow, that's crazy, guys, because you are as spiritual as you can ever be in Christ Jesus because you have the Holy Spirit of God because you place your faith in Jesus Christ. So the problem with this asceticism, this discipline, if you will, this avoidance of all forms of indulgence, is it puts all the emphasis on our flesh, right? And ignores the source of the problem. And you know what the source of the problem is? I think all of you probably know this by now. It's our heart. This is a heart issue. It's not something that our flesh... Listen, if your flesh was salvageable, right, in its condition right now, you wouldn't be getting a redeemed, right, flesh that is not corruptible. You wouldn't be getting that. You wouldn't be getting a new body, so to speak, right? God would just take what you have and he would make it, you know, to be, you know, not corruptible, okay? Paul says it like this. You must take off the incorruptible, the corruptible and put on the incorruptible. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. So this is absolutely a heart issue, and it has to do with our sin nature. It deals only with the external things, and it doesn't address the internal problem, the heart. And listen, Jesus spoke to this. I don't want to go there for the sake of time, but for you note takers, Matthew 23, verses 25 through 26, Jesus told the Pharisees this as he gave them the seven woes. He says, "Woe to you Pharisees, you hypocrites! Should you not have first cleaned the inside of the cup and then clean the outside of the cup?" They were so worried about what other people thought about what they did or what they didn't do or how they looked or how they prayed or how they fasted or whatever it is they were doing in a religious way. They were more worried about the outside, about what men and women thought about them, than they were about what God thought. And so listen, guys, the only way to clean the inside of the cup, right, and you can liken all of us to cups, right, is by filling it with something good and something pure and something holy, which you can't find that anywhere in the temporal. You find that in Christ Jesus when you put your faith in him. And at that time, you get the Holy Spirit and he cleanses you of all unrighteousness. Do you guys see this? You want to fix the heart problem, right? You fix the heart with the only one that could fix the heart problem, God. So I want you to see this, guys, because look, this is still very much a problem in the church today. And the reason why is because it makes you feel more spiritual and more close to God, but in actuality, it doesn't actually do it. All that's happened is you've now said, God, look at what I can do. Look at how spiritual I am. And God is like, no boy, no girl, you don't want me to look at how spiritual you are. You want me to look at you and see Christ, not you. Trust me, that's what you want, you know? And yet, we still at times are tempted to want to try to do these things or not do these things. And listen, guys, I can't say this enough. You have to be able to understand the difference between doing something or not doing something to worship God as an offering of worship to God as opposed to doing something or not doing something to receive more of God's grace or more of God's pleasure. Do you see this? God is completely pleased with you because now, for those with faith, because he's completely pleased with his son. Do you understand this? Like, God loves you that much. You cannot be more spiritual than you are right now in Christ Jesus. And all the stuff that people are saying, yeah, you know, you shouldn't be doing that. Well, you know, you should be doing this. Let Daddy worry about that. You just keep on believing. Keep on trusting in what God's doing in your life through the Holy Spirit. Again, our spirituality is complete in Christ. Christ alone fills us and indwells us with his Holy Spirit when we put our faith in him. I'm going to go ahead and read a verse to you. I read this verse often, and I love this because it's one of the other letters that Paul wrote at the time that he wrote this letter of Colossians. It's the book of Ephesians, and this is Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. And I read this verse often, guys, because this is something that I myself have to remember. Because I think I confessed to you guys last week that sometimes I find myself thinking that, well, I have to pastor and I have to teach because that's what makes me right with God. And it's like, no, D, that's not what makes you right with God. That's your call. You ought to be doing it, but that has nothing to do with your salvation, Dave. You guys know what I'm saying? And so sometimes I think we can put these things on us. And you know the enemy? He loves that. He wants us to think that there's additional things we need to do or not do. But I want you to see this. You don't get the Holy Spirit because of what you do. Look at this, Ephesians 1:13. Let me read this to you. It says this, in him, that's in Jesus, you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and you believed in him, and believed in Christ, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. The moment you gave your life to Christ, Christian, you got the Holy Spirit. The moment you gave your life to Christ, you became spiritual enough. You cannot be any more spiritual today. I don't care if you've been a Christian for 100 years. You are not more spiritual today. You are not more worthy today than you were the moment you first came to Christ with all your gunk and all your yuckiness. Maybe you're like, you know, Dave, but I'm not like I was back then. I'm different now. Well, you ought to be different now. But you being different now, you being more conformed in the image of Christ, doesn't make you any more perfect, any more spiritual, any more saved than that day when you gave your life to Christ with all your gunk. I want you to see this, Christian. Because, man, we beat ourselves up so much. Am I doing enough? Am I spiritual enough? Or maybe I shouldn't be doing that. You know? If you walk in faith led by the Holy Spirit, God will cleanse you of the things that he wants to remove from your life. Now, I'm not sitting up here saying that, you know, if you see a sin that you're stuck in, that you shouldn't address it. That's not what I'm saying. But we go to the extremes, and we start trying to make those things about our salvation. You guys remember the thief on the cross? I love that story. Man, it always gets me kind of teary-eyed when I think about it. Because this is a person who lived his whole life as an enemy of God, as an enemy to his fellow neighbor, and as an enemy to his community. And yet he's on a cross, deserving what he's getting on that cross, death. And he utters a few words to the Savior. Lord, remember me when you enter into your kingdom. And what does Jesus say? Today you will be with me in paradise. He didn't say, well, you know what? I'm going to have to get you to climb up off this cross, man. I'm going to make a way so you can get off this cross. You can go and clean yourself up and you can be as spiritual as you need to be. Then you can come back, climb on a cross, and then I'll get you into heaven. Christ said, today you will be with me in paradise. And it was one simple act that caused that. His faith. Do you see this, guys? I want you to see this, Christian. It is so important. So important. When you're led by the Holy Spirit, he causes you to bear his fruits. Galatians 5, 22 through 23. Love, joy, peace, kindness, long-suffering, etc., 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 right? And actually, you know what that is? when you're bearing fruit by the Holy Spirit, by faith in Jesus Christ, that is actual, true, acceptable Christian asceticism before the Lord. Not stuff that you're doing on your own efforts. Know the difference between worshiping God in what you do or you don't do and trying to get brownie points with God in what you do and you don't do. Don't get brownie points. You don't need them. You don't need them. Just worship God. And if you choose to worship God by recognizing one of the Jewish feasts or not doing this or doing, you know, it's like sometimes, you know, we'll we watch movies, you know, with our children, and as God is my witness, we don't let them look at any kissing scenes. As a matter of fact, we don't look at kissing scenes. You know, I'll try to forward if I remember it, or but they always turn their heads. Even my 24 and a half year old son turns his head when he's in the presence of me and we're watching a movie where there's a kiss, even if it's a peck. I don't let them do that. But I'll tell you right here and now, if you ask my kids, does that save you? They say, no way, Jesus saves me. I'm doing that to honor my God. I'm doing that to glorify my God. Do you see, guys? Let's continue there. Paul continues there. I know I beat that up, but he continues after asceticism. He says, and worship of angels. This idea of worship of angels, the Greek word there is angelos, and it means messengers or saints. And I want you guys to know that really it's just a messenger of God. Now, absolutely, it could be an angel. And most of the time when you read that word in the Greek, right, it is an angel. But in the book of Revelation, some believe that that very word angelos, regarding the angel of this church and the angel of that church, is actually the pastor of that church. In other words, it's a saint, right? Because we saints, are we not messengers of God? You know? And so I want you to see this because Paul is actually referring to both in this text, I believe, okay? He's referring to worship of angels and worship of saints. And listen, I can see why the Gnostics would try to get the Colossians to try to worship angels. And even Christians that have already passed on to go to be with the Lord. I can see why they'd want to do that because as we're taught in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 7, the angels are a little higher than men, right? So logically, right, we think, well, you know, in proximity, they're kind of closer to God, so we can worship them, right? And so I want you to see this because, listen, the Gnostics believe that God is so holy and we are so wicked that we can't directly approach God. So they would teach, you got to go through a middleman. You got to go through an intercessor. And they believed that the angels, the messengers of God, were the intercessors for us, between us and God. You guys see this? I mean, it's just, yeah, it's wickedness, sister. Amen, right? Wickedness. So they taught that we should not only worship angels, right, but also that we should pray to angels. And if you guys don't know, prayer is a form of worship, right? So the whole gamut here. Now, the problem with that is this, is that Jesus actually taught that we are to pray directly to the Father in his name. I want to go to John 16. And I want to read verses 23 and 24. Jesus says this to his disciples as he was promising to give them the Holy Spirit, that he must go so the Holy Spirit can come. He says, in that day, you will ask nothing of me, right? Because they're hanging out with Jesus. They see him there. They're able to, you know, give him bumps and, you know, hug him and, you know, talk to him and, you know, the whole nine yards. But he says, in that day, you will ask nothing of me. Truly, truly, I say to you, whatever you ask of the Father. You see this, Christian? Whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he will give it to you. Until now, verse 24, you have asked nothing in my name. Ask and you will receive, that your joy may be full. And you know why your joy is full in Christ? When you ask the Father something in his name and he does it for you? Because you know that you can go to Daddy directly now. And that's a very joyous thing. You guys know what I'm saying? Think about this culture. This is the Jewish culture. How did they talk to God in this time? They went to the temple,
during the hour of prayer, right? And they asked the priests to make offerings for them and sacrifices to them, etc., etc., etc. This is how they did that. And they believed that those things were kind of like middle things between them and God. But Jesus says, now you can talk to the Father directly. You guys, and listen, Jesus isn't just teaching that you can do it. He's telling you that's how it's done now because I've come. Not only did Jesus teach, right, that we could pray directly to the Father, Jesus taught that God wants to know us in a relationship. Like, I talk to all of you often, right? All of you that come to our church on a regular basis. When you come to church, I go up and I say, hi, how you doing, right? But if, think about this. What if I, like, went up to say, Brother Chris, and I say, hey, Brother Chris, go tell Brother Rob, shake his hand and tell him I said hi. You know, I mean, Brother Rob is like, man, that's not even a relationship, bro. I don't even know you, you know? But God, he wants us to know him directly. Again, John 17:3. Not only that, Jesus taught, right, that God wants to dwell with each of us in a personal relationship. Listen to what it says in John, same there, Gospel of John, chapter 14, verse 23. Jesus answered him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him. Do you see this, guys? Very personal. And we will come to him. We is Jesus and the Father. And we will come to him and make our home with him. Wow. God, the Father, wants to know you. He wants to make a home with you. You don't need to have a middleman, right? And then Jesus, God the Son, we are taught in Romans 8, verse 34, in Hebrews 7, verse 25, Jesus, God the Son, is our intercessor. We don't need an angel. We don't need a saint. We don't need any other intercessor. Jesus is our intercessor. And as a matter of fact, Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25 tells us that God is there at the right hand of the Father making intercession for us all day long. I mean, go figure that. I don't even know that. Now, for me, I kind of get it. I know, because I'd be tripping, right? But, you know, like, he's doing that all day. He's our intercessor. It's beautiful. Sadly, guys, some Christian religions actually teach that it's okay, and I put quotes around Christian, that it's okay to pray to or to worship saints. And they say, well, you know, we're not actually worshiping the saint, we're venerating the saint, or we're venerating the Virgin Mary, you know? And if you go look up the word venerate, it means to respect greatly or to revere. Deep reverence. Guys, we're called to honor each other, not to revere each other. We honor each other in the Lord. And the reason why we honor each other is for two reasons. First and foremost, because we have Imago Dei. We have the image of God upon us. So we honor each other in the value and the sanctity of the life that God has given us. But we also honor each other as the saved of Christ, as children of God, as co-heirs with Christ. But we never revere each other like we would revere God. And so actually, what's happened is those other religions believe that they can pray to certain saints and they can ask them for specific special things. You know, like you can pray to Paul and you can ask him for a specific thing. Now, there's some things you can't ask Paul for. You got to go ask Mary for that. And then there's another saint, you know, in Guam, it's the patron saint, Fatima. And I'm not sure what she did. I think she was pretty awesome, you know, when she walked on the earth as a believer in Christ. But we can go pray to her for something, and I don't remember what it is. Like, that's part of my culture on Guam, right? But the fact is, guys, that's blasphemy, right? As if having this person, right, that to go, you know, you can ask them to go ask God, hey, go ask God for me for this, okay? I think I've told you guys this before. I know this family where there was three boys in the house, and the two older boys were, like, probably, I don't know, 7 years or older than the youngest boy. And that little boy, he was so cute, so beautiful, beautiful boy. They would go to him and say, hey, go ask mom for candy. You know? Like, that's what they would do, right? And so it's like, that's what we're doing, right? And it's like, look, why don't you go ask daddy yourself? You have that ability. And daddy will hear you because you are in Christ. Do you see it, Christian? You don't need a middleman. And so not only do they ask by praying to these saints, if they could have this and they could have that, right? But in order to try to entice them, because maybe they're concerned that the saint won't actually go ask God, they worship them. They worship them by burning candles and offering up this and offering up that in the name of this saint and that saint. And it's just, it's really crazy. And so look, I want to jump ahead here because it's getting late, but I want to say this, guys, look, God cares about your cares. Do you understand that? God cares about every single care that you have. He cares about all your anxieties, from the least to the greatest. 1 Peter 5, 6 through 7 assures us of this, guys. And so I want you to know something here, okay? And I don't feel like I'm stretching it here. I want you to know something. Don't ever think that you're bothering God even with the least of your cares. Don't ever think that. If you've ever had a child, you know, and I have 6 children and I have 4 grandchildren. My 4th grandchild was just born a week or two ago, and I'm so excited about that. But you know what my greatest pleasure is with my children and my grandchildren is when they come and they ask me something. And I don't care how small it is. It could be the smallest thing in the world. It's important to me. How much more do you think our Heavenly Father cares and just, man, you just melt him when you go to him like that. You understand? He loves you like that. When Jesus says, it's for this reason that we cry, Abba, Father. That word Abba is daddy. Growing up where I grew up, you know, a lot of my friends didn't have dads in the house. And the ones that did have dads in the house, they were a walking nightmare. You know? They would never call their dad daddy. You know? But I know a father that we can call daddy, and he loves you like that. So don't ever think that you're bothering daddy with the least of your concerns. It's a big deal to daddy because it's a big deal to you. I want you to know that. The other thing I wanted to show you really quickly on this idea of angel worship is that this has been a problem in the church since Jesus at least first came on the scene. And we know this, and I'm not going to go into great detail about this, but we know this because remember the temptations that the enemy brought on Jesus? Remember the last one, what he said? He said, you see all these kingdoms of the earth? I'll give them all to you if you just what? If you worship me. Remember that? Luke chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. Now, what is Satan? He's a fallen angel. Do you see this? He's a fallen angel. He's trying to get Jesus to worship him. Do you see it? And Jesus was like, it is said regarding the word of God, you shall worship only the Lord your God. So I want you to know something, Christian, okay? This has always been a problem in the church. John, you guys know the book of Revelation? I think you might know it. It's the last book in the Bible, right? John, the writer of the Gospel of John, wrote the book of Revelation. Some people think that it's dated as late as 95 AD. This guy would have been an old man at that time. And yet twice, while he was getting the prophecy from Jesus, he tried to worship an angel. And what did that angel? Don't worship me. No, get up, bro, get up. You know, I always laugh at that because the same thing happened to Peter in Acts when he had healed the man at the gate called Beautiful that was crippled. And the guy was going to worship Peter, and Peter was like, no, bro, get up. And I could just see Peter like, looking, no, he don't know what he's doing. God, please, don't be mad now, you know, like, I got him. I'm directing him right. But John, who walked with Jesus, who saw the miracles, who heard all the teaching, who received the Spirit directly from Jesus Christ, Jesus literally breathed the Holy Spirit on him. John, at the end of his life, is still trying to worship angels. So I don't want you to think that you can't, I'll never fall into that. Fine, you won't. Make sure you don't. It is still very much a problem and a danger that we think that we can go to someone else to go talk to God. And Jesus is like, I paid for that so that you can go directly to God. Any angel that would have you worship him is not an angel of God. Any saint that would have you worship him is not an angel of God. Hence, Peter said, don't worship me. Hence, the angel in Revelation said, don't worship me. Anybody that's not coming from God, absolutely. Yeah, worship me. I'm great. You know? That's the difference. And the Gnostics were trying to get the Colossians to do this. Continuing there, it says, going on in detail about visions, puffed up without reason by the sensuous mind. I just quickly want to touch on this. These visions can be fake or they can be real to the ones that are having them. And I don't know if you guys heard anybody say, hey, I had a vision, God gave me a dream, and this kind of a thing. And that's fine. And I'm not saying God doesn't do that. God absolutely does that. Okay? And he might even do that to you. I know a couple of brothers that they have that gifting. Okay? And they get these visions and they get these dreams. They actually live in our community. Right? And they're very godly. They're God glorifying. And there hasn't been too many times, if that I can remember, that either of them, when they've told me a dream or something, that it wasn't actually really something that happened. You know what I'm saying? So I believe God still does this. But what Paul is talking about here is he's talking about visions and dreams that these people are saying so that they can be prideful of themselves, so that they can be glorified, so that they can show everybody how spiritual they are. As again, it says right there, continuing in that verse, it says, puffed up without reason by his sensuous mind. A sensuous mind is a carnal mind. It's a mind of the senses. And so this is what Paul is speaking to, right? He's saying that these people with these visions, it's coming from their desire to be worshipped. It's coming from their vain conceit, their self-confident, carnal, man-made wisdom. And so they literally brag, about these things that they say they're seeing, right, in the temporal, but I believe they really weren't seeing them at all. And guys, look, they're bragging about it so that they can say, well, I'm going to follow this guy because he has some special knowledge that can make me more spiritual and make me more Christian. Guys, it's just another branding of New Age religion. And the difference between New Age spirituality and Christ-centered spirituality is just that. New Age spirituality is about you. It's about you getting better, right? It's about fixing you. Literally, it's like the problem we had in the garden, wanting to be God. You can be like God. You know what I'm saying? Where Christ-centered spirituality is simply just that. It's Christ-centered. Again, verse 19, he says, and not holding fast to the head from the whole body, nourished and knit together through its joints and ligaments, grows with a growth that is from God. And so Paul is telling you the secret here. The reason why these people are like this, why they practice asceticism, while they try to talk about these visions that they're having, and they do all these things to be more spiritual, is because they literally have not held fast to the head. The word head there in my translation is capitalized because it's talking about Jesus Christ. Meaning, they are not continuing in their faith in Christ alone. And then he continues there and he says, from the whole body, nourished and knit together through its joints and ligaments, grows with a growth that is from God. And so, because they have detached themselves from Christ, they no longer are growing. They want to grow. They have a desire to grow, but they're pursuing it outside of Christ. But you and I, Christian, if you want to grow spiritually, you continue in your faith. It's not on your time that God is going to make you what he wants to make you. It's on his time. And quite often, the reason why he hasn't taken you to this new place or to this deeper place is because he knows that you're not ready. But do you trust him to get you there? Then just continue in your faith. And if you have a struggle with something, continue to repent. Repentance is a beautiful gift of God. Continue to repent and turn yourself back to Jesus. Repent and turn yourself back to Jesus. I know at times you're like, Lord, this is never going to leave me. This is never going to end. I promise you, if you continue in your faith, it's all part of God's molding you and strengthening you and stretching you, conforming you more into the image of his Son for his glory and for your growth. And this is what Paul is speaking to you guys. So when Paul says, let no one disqualify you, he means at least these two things. Don't let anyone disqualify you regarding spiritualism, right? Meaning, don't let others make you feel like you're disqualified because you're not spiritual enough. Okay? Are you in Christ? Then you're spiritual enough. Period. End of discussion. And also, don't disqualify yourself by saying to yourself, well, I don't think I'm spiritual enough. I'm going to have to do this too to be saved. Don't do that, Christian. It's heresy. And again, at the end of the day, it's not holding fast to the head. It's not holding fast to Christ. it's not continuing in your faith. The one who's truly spiritual in God's eyes, guys, is the one who is connected to Jesus, walking by faith in the Holy Spirit. Let me continue there, verses 20 through 23, and we are going to finish it today. Thank you, God. If with Christ you died to the elemental spirits of the world, why, as if you were still alive in the world, do you submit to regulations? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. So I love this, guys, because I'm just going to stop there on those two verses. I love this because he says, if with Christ you died. Do you see this? Listen, the day you gave your life to Christ and you became alive in Christ is the day that you died to the world. You died to the world and all of its ways to try to be righteous and try to be moral. You know, and look, a lot of the things that Christianity, professes as moral before the Lord, okay, the world is in agreement with. Most of the world agrees that murder is immoral. You guys know what I'm saying? I would say that most of the world agrees that theft is immoral, but I don't think so. I actually see where people celebrate that now as they loot stores and shoplift and they say it's okay. But at least the murder thing is still very much immoral to the world, you know? But doing that or not doing that, guys, right, doesn't make you any more in Christ. So we don't need a law that says don't murder. That's written on our hearts. We have the Holy Spirit, and when we walk in the Holy Spirit, we walk in a way that we don't murder. And you guys are saying, Dave, I'd never murder anybody. Listen, Jesus said if you hate somebody, you've murdered them. So don't say you would never murder anybody. According to Jesus, I mean, I know I've murdered plenty of people in my hatred, right? So don't even go there, right? So my point is that, listen, as Paul says here, if with Christ you died to the elemental spirits of the world, why, as if you were still alive in the world? Christian, you're dead in the world. You were buried with Christ when you gave your life to him. Why, if you were still, as if you were still alive in the world, do you submit to regulations? You know, again, Paul is not saying, you know, do or don't do something unto the Lord in worship. Paul is saying, do or don't do something. Don't do it as if it's going to save you or make you more spiritual before God. This is what he's speaking to. Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. Again, Christian, we now live with Christ. Colossians 2:13. We live with Christ by the Holy Spirit. 2 Timothy 2:11. Romans 6:5. Romans 6:8. On and on and on. There's all kinds of verses of this truth. You are alive in Christ. Thank you, Jesus. And you have the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. You're alive with Christ, not by the elemental spirits of this world. Man-made regulations, man-made principles, man-made morality, okay? You're not alive in Christ from those things, okay? So now that you're alive in Christ, live in Christ, not the world, okay? We are no longer subject to the world's regulations. We are free in Christ from the regulations of this world. And listen, at the end of the day, guys, those regulations deprive you and I. You know, the day that my granddaughter, her name is Emery Maeve, okay, when she was born just a week ago, you know what I did? I praised God. I praised my Lord. I looked up at him and I said, thank you, God. She's got 10 fingers, she's got 10 toes. The doctor says she's healthy. She's alive, you know. Man, you are a good God. Thank you for the good life. Thank you for the faithfulness. When you start saying, don't do this and don't do that and don't touch this and don't touch that, you're actually taking away opportunities by which you can praise God for these things that God has given you and by faith and prayer are made sanctified through thanksgiving. Don't fall into that, guys. You have a beautiful life. Look, we live in a very free country, the freest in all the world. You know, we should be more thankful to God than any other culture on the planet. Don't take away opportunities to thank God. Don't take away opportunities to look and see the beauty that God has given you in his blessing so you can turn back and praise him and worship him in it. And that's what we do when we deny that. God wants us to enjoy the blessings that he gives us. He just doesn't want them to become the object of our worship. He wants those things to make us look to God and say, God, I realize that I am imperfect. I realize that I am unworthy of another healthy, beautiful granddaughter. But yet from your love of me, Daddy, you gave me another one. Do you see it? Man, we have a beautiful God. Continuing there, verse 22. Referring to things that all perish as they are used. Guys, all these things are going away. When the new heaven and the new earth come, all this stuff's going away. We get so attached to it. You know, we have collections of this and we mound up, stuff in our pole barns and in our attics and in our basements. And you go down there and you ask somebody, well, you know, what's this? And you're like, I don't even know. I don't even remember when I bought that thing. Well, maybe we should take it to Goodwill or give it to somebody that needs it. Oh, no, I think I should keep that. You know, it's like, come on. You know, all this stuff is going away. All this stuff is going to perish. Continuing there, second half of verse 22. According to human precepts and teachings, he's asking the question, why? Don't take away those opportunities to worship God. Continuing there, verse 23. These indeed have an appearance of wisdom in promoting self-made religion and asceticism and severity to the body, but they are of no value in stopping the indulgence of the flesh. Uh-oh. You guys see that? Let me read that to you again. So, like, think about this, hypothetical here. You are trying to live legalistically. You are trying to live more spiritually. And Paul just dropped it on you. He just said, when you do that, it has no power from stopping you or preventing you from actually partaking in your sin. And Christian, I'm going to go further than this, and I know this personally. I believe that when you focus on trying not to sin, right? And usually what you're focusing on is those sins that you're most weak with, right? When you are focused on trying not to do that or fall into that, it's in those times that you fall into it more. I can guarantee that. I know that personally. Again, when I came to the Lord, I was obviously much older, right, than a lot of people. I wasn't at some Christian camp at 12 and gave my life to Christ. I was older when I came to the Lord. I didn't even understand or know the gospel until I was in my mid-20s. You know what I'm saying? But when I did, I had so much worldly baggage and so much spirit or fleshly wickedness that it was a hard thing once I went on the other side of faith. Because I wanted to be holy. I wanted to be righteous. I wanted to be good for Daddy. But I kept finding myself falling. You know what I'm saying? And look, it wasn't just like I was falling to all these different things. It was the same two or three things. And think about this, right? And I'm going to speak it from a marriage perspective, right? Your spouse continues to do something wrong to you, whatever it is. It could be really little or really big. I don't care what it is. And they keep coming back and saying, please forgive me. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Forgive me. After about the 100th, umpteenth, billionth time, don't you think that the word sorry loses its value at that point? You know, with God, it never does. Never does. I always say this, and this is one of my greatest hopes. This is one of my greatest peace, right? Of all the peace that I have is when Jesus uttered this, 70 times 7. Peter's like, how many times do I have to forgive him, Lord? 7 times? No, 70 times 7. You know that word, that number 7? It actually symbolizes completion, perfection. So whenever you see that number in the Bible, 7, it means that's enough. That's complete. This is why Peter said 7 times, right? This is why. Actually, in that time, it was tradition to forgive somebody 3 times and then you don't have to forgive them anymore in the Pharisaic Judaistic tradition. So Peter was even going further and he was saying 7 times. And Jesus is like, no, 7 times 10 times 7. Meaning you keep on forgiving him. And so I was in these couple of 2 or 3 sins and I didn't understand this yet. I really didn't understand grace yet. I was still kind of in that mode where I was trying to live right for God on my own. In other words, legalistically, right? And so, guys, this is going to blow you away, but Pastor Dave, I was about to walk away from the Lord. This was like early on in my walk, 2 years in, because I felt dirty and I kept on blowing it, you know? And so I got on my knees and I said, I'm just going to pray to God one more time and I'm going to apologize to him and I'm going to let him know I can't do this. And I got on my knees. I'll never forget it. I was actually, at one of my couches in my office, and I said, Lord, you know, I can't do this. I keep falling. And it's the same thing. It's not even different sins, God. I keep letting you down. I keep falling. You know, I keep trying and trying and trying, and I can't do it. And it was almost like an audible voice. You know what it said to me? It said, that's right, boy, you can't do it. Now rest in my grace. Rest in my peace. Christ has paid for that. Christ has delivered you from that. Now own it. Stop looking at it. Stop trying to defeat it. You in and of yourself can't defeat it. As a matter of fact, you in and of yourself love that. Your flesh loves that. But in my Son by the Spirit, you have victory. And you guys want to know something? I don't have that problem no more. I haven't had that problem in 20 years. Thank my Lord, you know? And I want you to have that. Paul is saying, these things have an appearance of religion and it looks good and wow, he's just so holy and righteous. But they have no value to stop you from sinning. They have no value to make you more spiritual. They have no value to make you more before God. You are fully spiritual in Christ before the Lord. And if you want to overcome a struggle that you have today, then rest in the peace of Christ. Receive the grace of God and stop toiling, trying to defeat something that you will never be able to defeat with your efforts of legalism, with your efforts of spiritualism. Remember, we talked last week about the Sabbath. Rest in the Sabbath that you have in Christ every moment. And you watch what happens to that sin that seems to just have a hold of you so strong. It'll run to the mountains, man. It'll never bother you again. My Lord kicked its butt in my life. Thank you, Jesus. Let's finish here with this, guys. Because what I want you to see here is that we've been talking last week and this week about legalism and spiritualism, and Paul is saying neither of them save, right? You don't need to do them at all. But I want you to see something. Look, when you clean the inside of the cup first by grace through faith and you receive the Holy Spirit and become as spiritual as you could ever be without needing any more, guess what happens? It actually shows itself on the outside. And all those legalistic works that you tried and toiled so hard to do, they actually happen in your life. They're not called works. God calls them fruit. Do you see it? So in Christ is where the legalism that man pursues and the spiritualism that man pursues is found, and it's only in Christ where those two come together at a head and God says, yes, acceptable. Instead of you trying to be legalistic and God's like, sorry, man, you got to try harder. That's not good enough. Or you trying to be more spiritual. Sorry, not good enough. Do you see it, guys? In Christ is where spiritualism, true spirituality, and true works, which is fruit, is met and accepted before God. James says, faith without works is dead. The works that James is talking about is this fruit that is evident from the Spirit in your life. Know this, Christian. Live this and own this, guys. So let me finish with these last few words. In Christ, we died to legalism. In Christ, we died to spiritualism. We no longer have to partake in either of those things to please God because it's not possible to please God by these things. Hebrews 11:6 says that only by faith can we please God. Write that down, Christian. Hebrews 11:6, only by faith can we please God. And the reason why? Because only in Christ is God pleased. And it's by faith that you are in Christ. And so therefore, if it's by faith that you are in Christ, now live and walk in Christ. I want to read to you one last verse before we close here. Maybe two, but it'll be quick. Galatians Chapter 2, verse 20. Listen to what Paul writes. And you guys know this verse. This is one of the staple Christian verses. He says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me, and the life I now live in the flesh. Do you see this? Christ lives in me spiritually, and the life I now live in the flesh outwardly, right? I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if righteousness were through the law, then Christ died for no purpose. Christian, live and walk in Christ, and you will be the things that you're supposed to be outwardly, and you will be the things that you're supposed to be inwardly. I love you guys. Know that. Live in that. Daddy loves you. Christ loves you, and he paid it all so you can have your freedom and have your peace in him. Last thing I want to say is, if you don't know the Lord today in a relationship, I ask you please to repent of your sin and place your faith and your trust in Jesus. That's all God is asking of you, to place your faith in Jesus' life, in Jesus' death, in Jesus' resurrection. Let him be your righteousness today. Let him be the propitiation for your sins, because there is no other way but by Jesus. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you and praise you so much, God, that in Christ we don't need to be legalistic. In Christ we don't need to be extra spiritual. When we walk by faith in Jesus Christ, we are enough. We are enough inwardly, we are enough outwardly, because Jesus is more than enough. And God, I just want to pray for all the hearts of all the people that are your children today that are hearing this message, God. Maybe they've had a struggle with really understanding their identity in Jesus Christ. Maybe they've had a struggle, God, with toiling and thinking, God, that somehow, if I only just do this too, along with my faith in Christ, maybe that'll be enough. Well, God, I pray that they would repent that, God, and that they would take a deep breath, a sigh of relief, that we now are free in Christ. Our Jesus paid it all. Thank you, God, that we can lay our heads down on the pillow, come what may, and we are going to be with you. We're with you for all eternity. And more importantly, you're with us. You accept us in Christ. You love us in Christ. You have received us in Christ. I just ask for the peace. I pray for the peace and the rest of all the people today, that they would know this truth, God. I also want to pray for the hearts and the souls that heard this message today that don't know you, God. Maybe in the conviction of your Holy Spirit on their hearts, maybe they've been pricked today. I just pray, God, that they indeed would repent of their sin, turn away from their sin in the world, and turn to Jesus in faith as Lord and Savior. I pray, God, that that would happen this very moment in their lives, God, as there's no moment soon enough, God. We just don't know when we're going to go home, or rather go before you, God, and we need to make sure we're prepared with Jesus. Father, we love you and we praise you, God. Thank you that Jesus is enough. He's enough for us outwardly. He's enough for us inwardly. He's enough for us in all things. Thank you, God. And thank you, King Jesus. We bow our hearts and our heads before you. We're so grateful to you. We love you. We praise you. Bless the remainder of this service, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. As we sing this last song, I just want each of you, if you can, just to really consider like what Christ has done for you and where you stand today because of Christ, you know, before God. And just really experience the thankfulness, the gratefulness
It's really a beautiful place to be, guys, when we realize that. That we didn't bring anything to the table of God. God invited us to the table because of Jesus. It's beautiful. Beautiful thing what the Savior has done for us. There's nothing you have, there's nothing you can bring, right? Except a contrite heart, a broken spirit, a grateful heart to the Lord.
Got a lion inside of those lungs.
get up and praise the Lord.
Father God, we just thank you again for King Jesus, God. We thank you for the truth of your word today, Father. We ask as we end this service and we go, Father, that we go out in the world and we'd be light, that we'd be the hands and feet of Jesus, that we would tell somebody this week, Father, somewhere in our circles, Father, of life, about Jesus, God. And again, that though that truth would not fall on deaf ears, God. And just pray, God, that you'd be glorified by our lives. Again, we love you. We praise you. Again, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And we thank you, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, guys. Have a great week.